giornata del teatro.
Happy Theatre Day. I am Vito Minoia, theatre and education expert at the Carlo Bo University of Urbino. Here, with some colleagues, I founded, over 30 years ago, the Enigma University Theatre. With Emilio Pozzi, professor of theatre history, I also founded in 1996 the European review Catarsi Teatri delle Diversità, a publication that has contributed to the creation in 2011 of the Italian Coordination of Prison Theatre Project, an organization that involves more than 50 companies from 15 regions. It is in 2019 that the International Network of Theatre in Prison started its work. It is a partner organization of the UNESCO International Theatre Institute, and it connects operators from all over the world. It does so also thanks to the Antonio Gramsci International Prize for Theatre in Prison, established in 2016 in Urbania, the location of the annual international conference Teatri delle Diversità, Theatres of Diversities. It has so far offered the opportunity to promote the work of significant projects from Chile, Lebanon, Italy and the United States. We are gathered today to celebrate the 8th Day of Theatre in Prison in conjunction with World Theatre Day 2021. The International Theatre Institute, represented here by its Director General Tobias Biancone, who will speak at the end of the meeting, has been promoting World Theatre Day since 1962, every year on March the 27th. On this date, in theatres and cultural centres throughout the world, a single message resounds. It is entrusted to a renowned representative of world culture to share a reflection on key themes related to theatre and the culture of peace. This year, as we will see, it is the turn of the English actress Helen Mirren. The idea of celebrating the Day of Theatre in Prison was implemented in 2006 by the Enigma University Theatre in the prison of Pesaro. A national day of theatre in prison was made official in 2014 thanks to the Memorandum of Understanding for the Promotion of Theatre in Prison signed by the Department of Penitentiary Administration that year through the Higher Institute of Penitentiary Studies and the National Coordination of Theatre in Prison. More will join later, like the Roma Tre University and the Department of Juvenile and Community Justice. In the last international conference organized at the end of October 2020 with the title Dialogues Between Pedagogy, Theatre and Prison, Professor Andrea Canevaro, Professor Emeritus of Special Pedagogy at the University of Bologna, quoted Nelson Mandela, reminding us that no one truly knows a nation until one has been inside its jails. A nation, said Canevaro, should be judged by how it treats the least advantaged individuals. Starting from those who are marginalized can be important to make everyone count. Prisons shouldn't be the place that confirms a marked destiny of marginality and exclusion. The theatrical language in prison, thanks to its creative, artistic, and expressive peculiarities, becomes a privileged tool for intervention. It escapes imposed patterns and identifies forms of knowledge that are able to cope with a real educational emergency. More than 60 years have passed since the creation of the San Quentin Drama Workshop, the first theatre company of inmates that produced a memorable performance of Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot on the 19th of November 1957 in the San Quentin prison in San Rafael, California. Since then, theatrical experiences in the prisons of Europe, Latin America, and the United States, mainly, paved the way for the creation of many prison theatre companies and the development of a series of very diverse projects. For the most part, these projects are led by theatre professionals who went to work in prisons. These experiences have progressively allowed for the creation of new methods of action, styles and languages. Something new and completely original was born, a type of theatre based on listening within the prison walls, on the biographies of the people involved, on continuously reinventing the language of the scene according to the limits represented by the facilities and the exceptional conditions of this particular form of expression. In prison, we promote artistic work that is inevitably rich with a social dimension that impacts the dynamic between the inside and the outside, between hosting an audience in prisons during performances and going out to perform in public theatres, the plays that are produced in prison. Sometimes, after serving their time in prison, people had the opportunity to continue practicing the crafts of theatre as actors or technicians. Claudio Meldolesi, distinguished theatre historian, mentor and companion in our journey, in an essay entitled Imagination Against Marginalization, wrote, "The need for theatre flourishes with greater urgency in the places of denial. It expresses there more than elsewhere the need for defense, the desire of transformation, the necessity to collectively resist with our fantasy against the evil that devours individuals, forced into paralyzing submission." Today we will share with you two different stories. One comes from the north and the other from the south of Italy. The first is a project implemented in a prison for adults, and the second is a project addressed to minors. They represent together and are the symbol of a range of projects that have developed common objectives in the last 10 years in Italian prisons. It is an international training seminar that highlights two significant ways, those of Venice and Palermo. With beautiful video documentation, we will get to know these two experiences closely. The first, by Michalis Traitsis, director of the Balamòs Teatro Company, operating in the female and male penitentiary institutes of Venice, in conversation with Valeria Ottolenghi, theatre critic and member of the National Association of Theatre Critics. The second focuses on the experience of Claudio Collovà, director with a long-standing international experience, engaged in an enduring and exemplary work with juvenile criminal offenders and minors at risk of social exclusion in Palermo, who will have a conversation with Valentina Venturini, professor of History of Theatre and Performing Arts at the Roma Tre University. The power and expressive force of the people involved on stage, and that is represented by the images we will see, emphasizes the maturity of this phenomenon and the variety of knowledge that isn't connected to a single school of thought. We therefore hope for an evolution in future scenarios, hope for these to be oriented towards significant cultural and professional training, which requires further important institutional investments. An encouragement on this matter comes from the greetings we received from two exceptional professionals that showed great sensitivity and with which we open our seminar. The greeting of Professor Marta Cartabia, new Italian Minister of Justice and formerly President of our Constitutional Court, and the greeting of Professor Mauro Palma, National Guarantor for the Rights of Persons Detained or Deprived of Liberty, formerly President at the Council of Europe of the Committee for the Prevention of Torture and Inhuman or Degrading Treatment or Punishment. I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to send my greetings to you all for the National Day of Theatre in Prison. Let me start with a few personal memories I would like to share. My first real encounter with the world of prison was marked by two events during which I attended two important plays. The first was in 2015, I believe, in the Rebibbia Theatre. The title of the play was Dalla città dolente, From the Sorrowful City. It retraced the most evocative passages from the Inferno of the Divine Comedy. The second came as a gift offered to me by the San Vittore prison. This time I remember the date well. It was on the 15th of October 2018, at the end of my visit as a judge of the Constitutional Court there. It was a very intense morning with moments of dialogue and reflection on the Constitution. During the afternoon, together with my family, I enjoyed a moment of celebration, a concert, songs, and then a play. The play retraced the life of Frida Kahlo. In both events, two things struck me. The first was that men and women prisoners seemed to be reclaiming their lives while acting. Just like one of the actors said, the play that was being staged represented the drama of their lives. In the plays that were being performed, the actors could find the right words to speak about themselves, to tell their stories and define their experience. The intensity with which I heard the last verse of Dante's Inferno pronounced in the theater of Rebibbia, and then we emerged to see the stars again, still resonates for me today, as if it was pronounced a moment ago. It still deeply shakes my soul with the need of liberation it represented then and it represents now, a desire of liberation that embraces and goes beyond that of physical freedom. The second is that on both occasions I have seen plays made and performed with the participation of all the people involved in prison life. Inmates, operators, agents, volunteers, educators, all together on the stage. The importance of this symbolic element should not be underestimated because it conveys the idea of prison as a community made by people, full of humanity, capable of releasing a positive energy oriented to the reconstruction of a social bond. That one that has been traumatically broken when the crime was committed. As a consequence, in the context of the application of the punishment, theatre cannot be considered as a moment of mere entertainment, as a pastime filling an otherwise empty moment. I believe that theatre can be a significant opportunity towards raising awareness and inner freedom. My best wishes then to theatre, to those who make it, to those who bring it into prisons, with the hope of being able to enjoy it again together after this terrible pandemic that is making everything more difficult inside and outside prisons. There is a positive element within the Italian penitentiary system, albeit with many difficulties, as we all know. The positive element is represented by theatre projects that have been developed in many prisons. In a census conducted a few years ago during the Stati Generali, General Assembly, the number of theatre workshops was even higher than the total number of prisons in the country. Right, because in many places more than one workshop was developed. This value should not be connected, as the administration has sometimes done in the past, to a sort of recreational or entertainment activity. Instead, it should be included in the process of recovery of the self that is essential for any form of social re-education. What do I mean by recovery of the self? First and foremost, individuals must recover their own relationship with their body that, in prisons, is experienced under very particular conditions, both objective and subjective. The relationship with one's own body is an experience of avant-garde theatre where it is implemented and experimented. But prisons must also support people in rebuilding a relationship with words, with language. Next to the bodily dimension, there is also a linguistic dimension. The language of prison is a language of deprivation. Sometimes deprivation comes even before imprisonment, and it certainly increases with incarceration and imprisonment. In addition, the individual has to build or rebuild a relationship with reading and with a text, challenging oneself. As an actor, as an interpreter, means entering a subjective world that is different, but that functions as a mirror of one's own subjectivity. I named these three dimensions belonging to the recovery of the self because they have a connection with three different theatrical experiences. The experimental approach in which the bodily dimension is essential. The linguistic one in which words acquire a very precise sense that allows people to redefine things in their life. And the one that is sometimes considered less important, that is the representation of a text inside of prison. These are different approaches with very different values, but certainly they are all connected with a process of recovery of a personal dimension that doesn't correspond only with the annihilating dimension of the crime committed. Instead, such personal dimension leads the individual to reflect on the reason for being in that place without destroying the consciousness of the self that is the essential point for a re-education approach. Follow the flow and charm of the short video you're about to watch. Get the most out of it, knowing that its images are just a small part of the vast, extraordinary, theatrical, cultural and social commitment of Michalis Traitsis. I am Valeria Ottolenghi, theatre critic and member of the artistic direction of Destini Incrociati, the Festival of Theatre in Prison. It is an honor for me to speak here, now, about Michalis Traitsis. My admiration for him is boundless. Even if, after the video, we'll have the possibility to have a conversation with Michalis to get a few updates on his work inside the male and female prisons of Venice, on his poetics, on his work with the University Center of Ferrara and the schools, the time we have available will inevitably be too little for an adequate analysis. So I'd like to encourage you to collect information on the activities that are being organized by Michalis. That is what I'd like to tell you. Go to Balamòs Teatro's website. You will discover other projects characterized by commitment, work, not only university, school, prison, but also mental health projects and projects addressed to people with neurovegetative diseases, their families, social and health workers, doctors and university students. Let's now focus on prisons. I am really sad for not being able to meet in person, as we have done for so many years in Venice, to study and exchange our views on the occasion of the World Day of Theatre in Prison. Michalis is great at bringing people together. In particular, I remember one of these events at the Cini Foundation. In a large hall full of people, we listened to the contributions of highly skilled researchers and experts as well as to those from members of the national coordination that work in different cities. Michalis is an artist that has a very strong poetic. He is, though, always able to listen so that those who work on stage can recognize what is a personal elaboration and what has been developed with others. He understands well the importance of dialogue, also on a theoretical level. It has always been a great pleasure to participate in the meetings promoted by Michalis with the University of Ferrara about theatre in prison, within the crowded events promoted by the Revue Internazionale. Before focusing on the video, I would like to say something more about Michalis' ability to make the prison talk to the outside world. The following professionals took part in the projects in the prison of Venice: Judith Malina, Cesar Brie, Giuliano Scabbia, Pippo Del Bono. Not only that, during the Venice Film Festival, every year one of the artists participating in the festival meets the women prisoners of Giudecca. First they watch the films, then they discuss them, then they talk directly with the author. How exciting! I personally remember with great pleasure the events involving David Cronenberg and Emir Kusturica, and much more than this. It is now important to focus on his theatre. In the video, Marco Valentini shows, as always, a special intelligence and sensitivity in recording Michalis' works. Fragments of three plays in particular will be shown, and will maybe focus on them more with Michalis. Cantica delle donne, Cantica of women, with passages filmed in prison but also in theatres in different cities. Women singing, recollections, the symbolic red shoes on the stage, the threads that, however light, remind us of bars used to hang thoughts. Voci e suoni di un'avventura leggendaria, voices and sounds of a legendary adventure, with Ferrara's middle school students recalling the figure of Odysseus on the island of the Cyclops, with a blindfolded audience and flowing words and music that seem to almost touch you. I saw it twice at the Giudecca Women's Prison, and I would see it again. And Antigone, with that unforgettable image of dead bodies piled up, the faces close together. About his realization approach, about the ability to work in synergy also with students and people in prison, well, it will be really interesting talking with Michalis Traitsis in just a little while.
Oh, shit. Faremo che i limoni e le gocce di cioccolato ci raccontano di intimità, di consapevolezza, e di scambi e di progetti, e che ci accompagneranno quando il gelo delle economie trasforma le persone in mercanzie da barattare al minor costo. Faremo che nel buio leggeremo le pagine insalivandole con le dita. Faremo che le nostre incertezze e le nostre ferite resteranno intatte e aperte. Ma non è solo solitudine. Faremo che diremo grazie fin dentro agli occhi.
Ma quel giorno hai messo sul pavimento, dove ogni passo sembrava un gemito o un lamento, le scarpe che ti avevo regalato, rosse e con il tacco, e solamente e sola hai ballato. E ballato, e ballato.
Good morning, Michalis. It's a great pleasure for me to have this conversation with you and to talk about something I care for so much, which is theatre in prison. I know that for you, there is something that is very, very important. It's the same, I think, also for all those who work in this field. I'm referring to the continuity of theatre activities, to the fact that theatre workshops shouldn't simply be temporary projects. Do you want to talk about that? Yes. Let's say that the continuity of a project, especially in prison, is one of the basic elements for the success of the whole process. Theatre certainly needs a lot of space for planning and for designing. Above all, a permanent space is needed to be able to start an activity that can be perceived not just as an additional activity, but as an ongoing one, to be organized on a daily basis, ensuring that theater and theatrical activities happen on a daily basis is important. Our theater workshop is a permanent one. I really think it is almost a privilege to be able to say that about theater in prison. One of the many matters to be dealt with when focusing on theater in prison is also the content that is offered, or that is decided together with the group. We often hear about self-dramaturgy, but you are particularly fond of making prisoners measure themselves with classics. Of course, I would like to say, first of all, that I like this work on classical drama very much. When I enter a workshop context, the very first thing I try to do is to understand what kind of atmosphere there is, what kind of energy is flowing, what kind of identity there is within the group that can allow the creation of an artistic identity. It is therefore very important. It is the beginning of a listening process and an attempt to give the students the possibility to find a way, to find the time, to find the space, to raise their concerns, to show their desires, their visions, their qualities and their needs. Then it's on these things, on this material, that we try to see what kind of support we can provide for dramaturgy. We could put it this way, very briefly, that we try not to drop ideas vertically, but we try to create a context in which people can meet these dramaturgical texts more easily, even if they don't have any kind of theatrical culture whatsoever. I think that's one of your somewhat magical characteristics, isn't it? You can somehow keep the original plays intact, though they are filtered by those who interpret them, by those who encounter them. Professionals who work in prison use a specific workshop methodology, and oftentimes those who participate in these workshops in prison think that it is a different kind of theatre compared to others. The truth is that there are parallel research approaches and poetics that are somehow similar. And you make sure that they experience them through real people. Yes, obviously our intention is not making theatre as entertainment. Our intention is not making theatre as a hobby. The end is perceiving theatre as a place of work, as a place of effort, isn't it? As a place of work and effort that, however, creates satisfaction. So the work focuses on the individual, on self-awareness. It is a work that focuses on the person's relationship with others, on measuring oneself with one's own limits and conflicts, to try and start a process of transformation of the self that can allow the person to find another identity. And I'm talking about the identity of the individual as a person. Clearly, not the identity of the individual as a prisoner, because that would be extremely limited. And this is something that... Can you also name the people who participated and, in doing so, helped understand the differences, but also the similarities with your creative path? The idea of the plurality of encounters is very interesting. Of course, once we have strengthened our idea of doing theatre and therefore of creating a certain identity, I thought I could invite other artists, actors, directors, so as to give the inmates the opportunity to confront themselves with other sensibilities, with other identities. In any case, though, with professionals sharing our same views. Obviously, the founding principles, methodological, ethical, and aesthetic principles of theatre, are based on the so-called third theatre, on the avant-garde of the 60s and 70s. Therefore, there is a precise identity, and as a consequence, the fact of creating this movement of people, of professionals who come from outside, who share the same principles, the same methodologies, the same visions, well, all this gives to the workshop a greater space. It also gives the inmates the possibility of getting answers on what they do, answers that come from other people. They even came in the prison for workshops at Giudecca. Yes, these meetings consist on sessions that are about theatrical practice. So it is through the work that this relationship is created. It's there. They come to understand that there are some things that are done with other people too, but that go in the same direction. I know about Cesar Bri, Giuliano Scabbia, Cesar Bri, Pippo Del Bono, yes, Enzo Vetrano, Stefano Randisi. Yes, these are professionals, artists, actors who happened to be in Venice and for whom we managed to find a space, an opportunity to let them in. I'd like to say that none of them was paid for the collaboration. They all came in as volunteers, and this gave an additional value to the workshop and to the meeting. There is a collaboration too, not only with the Teatro Stabile del Veneto, but also with the Biennale of Venice. During the event in Venice, many artists and actors who had a theatrical experience collaborated with us. Gabriele Salvatore, Antonio Albanese, David Cronenberg. These people, these professionals, artists, came from different backgrounds with different identities, but they all go in the same direction. Yes, I could appreciate it as I also followed the collaboration. So the inmates watch the film first, and then when they meet the famous person, and I think of Kusturica, for example, in some way they are ready for this experience. And the discussions, I must say, are of great interest. There is a need for prison to have a connection with the outside world. And I know that you have been able and are able to create networks works that are a bit special, particular connections, for example, with university students, even in performances that are joined together in the final play. Yes, another very important principle is this. As soon as a strong identity in the prison group was built, I strongly wanted to put it in connection with other groups that had an equally strong identity. I'm obviously referring to groups I work with, such as the students of the University Theatre Centre of Ferrara, as well as the students of a middle school in Ferrara with whom I am doing a very interesting project. So, we're talking of two identities, two strong identities that dialogue within the prison. Either the groups come to prison to meet the inmates, or the inmates go out to meet university students or school pupils. All this, how can I say, creates dynamism, multiple opportunities for meetings, approaches, opportunities to enter a relationship through other identities and through the practice of theatre. All this shows that theatre is a great instrument to be used for social cohesion. This is true especially for prisoners. They can somehow overcome this very strong characterization of being an inmate, and they can try to build an identity through the practice of theatre that is that kind of identity that can help people, regardless of whether they are professionals or not, to be stronger in everyday life. I think our time is running out, so I wanted to ask you to talk about the space that you somehow managed to define as a theatre inside the Giudecca prison. I saw it many years ago and I came back several times, but I have seen it take on more and more of a theatrical identity. I think it's been a very complicated job. Indeed, this whole story of the physical space we built is a metaphor and represents the work that has been done. The physical space, and as a consequence, also the metaphorical space, the poetic space, is a very important element. When we started working in Giudecca, for example, in the women's prison, there was no space. There was a place that served as a connection between two different sections. So it was a place of passage, a place where phone calls were made, a place where people hang around. It has been extremely difficult to try and take that space for us because it was the only one that could allow us to do an activity with a group of people. We focused on it, protecting it, upgrading it. We slowly gave it a new identity, transforming it first into a theatre space and finally making it a real theatre. 2 years ago, we managed to get some funding and we set it up. It has become a small, equipped theatre room, and our ambition is, we have already used it as such, our ambition is for it to become one of the theatres of the city, an equipped theatre. I think this wish is the best way to conclude. A space inside a prison can become a space for performance, a space for making theatre with an audience of people both from within the prison and from the outside. And I think this is a very precious wish project, and I hope you will be able to make it happen. Thank you very much for this conversation, Michalis. Thank you, Valeria. Thank you. Theatre is for me a moment of grace in which the infinite imagination of us men transfigures the daily bread of existence into the radiant body of eternal life. That always concerns me closely. For Claudio Collovà, theatre is the place where the memory of every man meets the rhythm of his own heart as a child, where the infinite imagination of man exercises its power. In this, it recalls what Samuel Taylor Coleridge called voluntary suspension of disbelief. In his notes to Shakespeare's The Tempest, Coleridge likened theatre to a dream. In sleep, we pass at once by a sudden collapse into this suspension of will and the comparative power. In theatre, we are brought up to this point with the consent and the positive aidance of our own will. We choose to be deceived in order to be able not to believe, but to follow what we see. Claudio Collovà, director, actor and trainer in theatres, schools, universities and independent groups. He approached theatre thanks to Michele Perriera and to the wonderful and special world of theatre made by Antonio Neiviller, director, actor, scenographer, visual artist, poet of the scene, with whom Collovà shared a fruitful period of study and research. Professor of Direction at Ulm in Milan, at the University of Palermo, at the Academy of Fine Arts in Palermo and at the Academy of Fine Arts in Catanzaro. Collovà's plays have been and are produced by important national and international theatrical institutions, including the International Festival of the Orestiadi in Gibellina. He directed from 2009 to 2017, and which, with his direction, won the National Critics Award as the best contemporary theatre festival in Italy. He started working in prisons thanks to theatre, or rather thanks to his independent need for theatre. In 1997 he worked on a play about Pasolini, Miraggi Corsari. His poetics, mainly linked to painting and to the bodily dimension of the actor, got its inspiration not only from theatrical sources. He looked for real faces, like Pasolini and like Caravaggio centuries before him, true faces, simply because they are taken from the streets. This is how it started, following the suggestion of the mayor of Palermo, Leoluca Orlando, at the Centro di Prima Accoglienza, a non-prison institution that welcomes minors until the validation hearing. Claudio Collovà comes from theatre, and it's within real theatre that he wants to work, even when he works in prison, no matter what. It's strange. I have no special consideration, he says, to make about the relationship between theatre and juvenile prisons. The approach I have is not different from the one I would have in other situations. It is not theatre for prison, nor theatre in prison. It is simply theatre. I would like to define it as normal. It is indeed this normality that pushes me to continue working with them. I'm not changing my artistic path. The first step towards normality is to involve them, just as a director involves his actors. These guys have to deal with Magritte, Joyce, Pasolini, Shakespeare, with a deep knowledge and understanding that I didn't hide from them just because I was afraid they wouldn't understand. Theatre as an educational tool has been of fundamental importance to start rehabilitation processes, both as an instrument of socialization and as an opportunity of expression and creativity. It has been, before anything else, a social encounter, a dialogue between different sensibilities. Collovà's artistic journey has addressed juvenile discomfort since 1997, a 24 years' work with an ongoing collaboration with the Ministry of Justice, the Center of Juvenile Justice of Sicily, the Penitentiary Institute for Minors, the Social Services for Minors, and today the Department for Juvenile and Community Justice. Many plays, many acknowledgements, many battles fought. An objective that Collovà has always had is to make an organic, structured and protected theatrical work with minors, maintaining a high level of respect and quality as regards to the part of the creative process. He creates performances that are the result of pedagogical workshop activities and of training on the crafts of theatre. This interaction between artistic and technical training influences theatre with the logic characterizing art studios. It is inspired by the figure that independent theatre names theatrical artist. It is that one person that makes the show, produces the audience, takes care of carpentry and tailoring, does the cleaning. The search for stability does not correspond only only to the desire of seeing one's work reconfirmed, but the need to avoid jeopardizing one's efforts, undoing what has been created, closing doors after opening them. It is a model of re-education that is very different from the one we're used to. This is how I imagine the alternative prison, he writes, a workhouse that is based, just like theater, on important values, such as the relationship with others, respect, honesty, and humility. Equally important values as well, like punctuality, concentration, rediscovery of the body, and total lack of hostility. If you don't cooperate, you sink. If you don't stick together, you're easily shipwrecked. And, like the famous saying, everyone is necessary and no one is indispensable. The video we are about to see, Il Piccolo Amleto, is the result of a project with young people followed by external social services that was made and presented in Palermo in 2018 at the Franco Theatre National Premiere and repeated at the Teatro Biondo Stabile. We want to believe, wrote Collovà, that work in juvenile prison goes beyond the narrow prison walls, and that ours will become a city of reference for similar experiences. We are hoping that Palermo will present theatre as an authentic occasion for change. The starting point is young Hamlet's absolute refusal to obey the peremptory order of his father's ghost, seek revenge. This choice was suggested by the stories told by the young participants about obedience due to adults. You don't have to obey, they said, but choose disobedience when an adult orders you to seek revenge for murder with murder. There are many minors who are abandoned. The context in which they grow up prevents them from living a different life. This is not the case for everyone, but all too often we hear of minors being used for this purpose because they are not liable or, in any case, subject to shorter sentences. Once again, Shakespeare spoke to them, says Collovà. He turned on their attention and shifted the theme of the play. Love is dead, they told me, not the king. According to them, the real drama of the tragedy is the love of two young people that was too soon destroyed. This, in the end, became our starting point, our Hamlets. As in the group, all the men played Hamlet, didn't tell the tragedy of one, but that of many. And, as in the scene of library, were absorbed in reading and ignoring the cry of their father who continued to incite them to take revenge.
Bird of prey, bird of prey, flying high, flying high in the summer sky.
Chi volò? Dio mi guardi, fermati! Chi sei? Fermo! Dio mi guardi, alto là!
Ascolta, Amleto, fu detto che io dormivo nel mio giardino e mi appuntò una serpe. È una versione falsa della mia morte. Hanno ingannato te e tutta la Danimarca. Ascolta, voglio dirti la verità. La serpe che mi punse ora porta la corona. È venuto strisciando verso di me che dormivo tuo zio con in mano una fiala di veleno. Me lo ha versato nell'orecchio, Amleto. Ha ucciso il mio sonno. Nel sonno, la mano di mio fratello mi ha portato via vita, sposa e corona.
Fermo, fermo. Guarda me. Beh, bravo, ok. Capito il senso? C'è tutto scritto là, questo assassino che mi hanno fatto, quindi come se ti consegnassi proprio il libro della verità dove tu leggi come sono andati i fatti, mentre leggi poi per i fatti tuoi sei molto assorto nella lettura, sei molto concentrato, a un certo punto arrivi al rigo che non volevi proprio leggere. Ok?
Tenuto.
Bravo.
Qua c'è Giuseppe Letta, qua Davide, Giuseppe, io. Ma tu non ne sei un ah, casito.
Guarda dove sono io.
Io ti giuro sinceramente, io personale, pensavo che posso arrivare ai giornali solo con, come si chiama, cose negative. Mai con cose positive.
Io
ti
pure,
giuro a mia
io
madre,
pure.
Non ti sto scherzando. Io non so, c'ho spaccio, rapina.
Ti giuro. Ho tentato omicidio.
Cose del genere, ti giuro. Non pensavo mai che arrivo... queste con le cose positive.
Quindi io sembro un mandato di cattura. Ciao Davide.
Vabbè, questo breve facciamolo, glielo restituiamo a Davide.
Tanto la sai, perché il 9 e 2 la sai.
Certo che la sai, l'ha dovuta imparare perché tu non ti tegni.
Ma non mi piace che sei come
va. Va bene. Allora facciamo questa scena.
Grazie,
ma vattene.
Allora, saluto.
Ciao,
facciamo la scena di oh, Polonio vabbè, con sì. Davide.
Guarda, mi stava salutando per fare la scena. Un po' tutto. Allora.
Come sta il mio buon signor Amleto? Mi riconoscete?
Benissimo. Siete il pescivendolo.
Oh no, mio signore.
Peccato. Almeno sareste stato onesto.
Onesto, signore?
Sicuro, onesto. Il pescivendolo è onesto. Oggi uno tra 10.000. Avete una figlia?
Certo, signore.
Bene. Non fatele prendere sole. Stare all'aria aperta fa bene, ma si corrono dei rischi. Fate attenzione, Polonio, amico mio.
Che cosa state leggendo, mio signore?
Parole.
Va bene, ho capito. Ma di che cosa si trattano?
Chi? Che cosa? Chi?
Volevo dire l'argomento della vostra lettura.
Giuseppe. Niente, fesse... da dietro ma a camminare.
Giuseppe.
Mio signore, che cosa state leggendo?
Parole.
Vabbè, ho capito. E di che cosa si tratta?
Chi? Che cosa? Chi?
Volevo dire l'argomento della vostra lettura. Ma se chi sono a rispondere dopo 6 secondi?
Perché chi dovevo rispondere?
Facciamo un'altra volta.
Da dove?
Da quando Giuseppe dice mio signore la latina vorrebbe...
Davide, di qua.
No, tu allora là.
Sì. A mia tale, racconta lì.
Ah, via.
Mio signore, la regina vorrebbe parlare subito con lei.
Ma cosa sono quelle?
Quelle sono le nuvole.
Oh, quanto son belle, quanto son belle, quanto son belle. Quella assomiglia a un cammello.
Ma infatti è un cammello.
O forse assomiglia di più a una donnola.
Tale e quale, è proprio una donnola.
Ma a me pare di più una balena.
Mio signore, è una balena.
Credo proprio che verrò da mia madre. Le nuvole si burlano di voi. Verrò tra poco.
Riferirò. Sta pure lì, oh.
Ci dai? E di un paiello, se non c'è.
Già?
Già, ti sotto di paiello.
Via, già.
Non c'è niente.
La sigaretta la devo spegnere qua.
Ah, che giusto che tu la... Guarda, alzati un attimo. Quando hai finito il dialogo di spalle, non è più giusto che tu la butti a terra e la spegni tranquillamente, me la fai vedere sta cosa?
Io ti ho detto la devo mettere a terra qua, la devo spegnere.
Basta che la spegni, ok?
Sì.
La butti qua e la spegni, dopodiché prendi lo specchio e gli dici, cambia anche il tempo perché vai un po' più in fretta verso di lei adesso, eh?
Ho qui uno specchio in cui potete vedervi fino in fondo.
Sono tale e quale sempre.
Parole atroci. Non vi ho mai conosciuto. Non vi siete mai conosciuta. Guardate questa immagine. E poi quest'altra. Sono i ritratti di due fratelli. Questo era vostro marito. Ora osservate l'altro. Questo è vostro marito. Avete occhi? Avete occhi? Oh, vergogna! Ma quale demone vi ha preso? Dov'è il tuo rossore?
Amleto, non parlar più. Le tue parole mi entrano negli orecchi come coltelli. Basta. Dolce Amleto.
Un assassino e un cialtrone. Uno che ha rubato la preziosa corona e se l'è scivolata in tasca.
Cioè tu ogni volta dici questo era mio padre, questo è vostro marito, questo era vostro
marito. Questo era vostro marito.
Invece è questo era vostro marito, questo è vostro marito. È così. Invece non è questo era vostro marito, questo... No, tu dici, questo è vostro marito, questo era vostro marito. Invece la frase è, questo era vostro marito. No, questo è vostro... No, Dio,
questo è vostro marito, ora osservate l'altro. Questo era vostro marito.
questo è vostro... No, questo era vostro marito. Ora osservate l'altro.
Questo è vostro marito.
E tu quale fotografia oggetti?
Come quella fotografia oggetti? Quella della sinistra.
Che è quella?
Del vostro marito. Del suo marito.
Del suo marito attuale, cioè sì, tuo certo. Zio, no?
Certo.
A posto. No, ricordatelo perché poi...
No, un po', tranquilla.
Mi chiamo Amleto. Ho 18 anni. Vivo in Brasov, via Vittorio numero 26. O meglio, vivevo libero e tranquillo. Me ne stavo sulla piazza con gli amici e parlavamo, sfumacchiando. Ora sono qui, chiamato per il funerale di mio padre, per il matrimonio di mia madre. Dietro corteo funebre, infatti, corteo nuziale, assassino e vedova. Che bella coppia. Non sono io pieno di dubbi. E tutta quella gente, amici, parenti, che non sanno se piangere la dipartita o tirare il riso agli sposi. Ora persino lo spettro che mi ha generato ha qualcosa da dirmi, o meglio da ordinarmi. Lascia in pace tua madre. Il rimorso si prenderà cura di lei. Ma lo zio no. Quello lo devi punire. Lascia infanzia e la gioventù e vendica l'onore perduto. Non mi resta che vivere qui, in questa prigione.
Bird of prey, bird of prey, flying high, flying high, am I going to die? Bird of prey. Bird of prey.
Siamo in carcere, ma è teatro.
We are in prison, but it's theater. You're right. I don't need them to tell me about them. I need them to understand that the condition of men, the one Shakespeare talks about, is theirs. I never wanted theatre to talk about them, nor did I ever believe their beauty comes from their situation. Yes, it is exactly as you say. I never felt the need to meet those young men in a different context than theatre, because theatre always takes me elsewhere. Once I enter the rehearsal room, I easily forget their condition. It's like everything disappears. And from here, I find myself working with them just as I work with professional actors. I am totally immersed in what I am doing. And it always ends up that I forget the rest. Of course, I get back to reality when rehearsals are over. I go home and they go back to their everyday condition that is unfortunately not happy nor simple. During rehearsals, though, the dream always ends up getting the better of everything. I have never been interested in their biography. Lately, I have worked on Shakespearean family tragedies that also have many points of contact with their lives. I remember when I did King Lear with them, what they told me at the end. Well, it's the story of my family, my father too, they said. All this with a strong accent in a Sicilian dialect. My father too. Split what he owed between us brothers, and the same war broke out. So many of the things Shakespeare talks about are easy to understand for them and close to their experience. In your experience, I see that there is no separation between theatre and the performance, between the process and the performance. There is always a profound awareness of the double role of theatre and of the value that it can have if these two aspects are not separated. In fact, you follow the process very closely so that the final moment of the performance doesn't compromise the benefits of that process. Why is there a final performance? It's clearly a provocation of mine, but you never gave it up and you have always made it by demanding a very high level of quality. I believe that every creative process has to lead to something. In this case, it must lead to a performance, which is also a necessary and essential moment. Neither one nor the other would make sense. That is why I have never accepted the idea of training as an end in itself. I have always tried to imagine training processes that were aiming at learning by doing. And in the end, the performance is the right outcome. It is also the right reward that these young men expect and that I expect. When I saw them receive the applause, I also saw them rejoicing in a particular way. Often, as you see in the video, some of the kids say that it's the first time they end up in the news headlines for something positive. And that fills me with pride. And I think that's crucial. Going on stage is also a liberating act because it puts an end to a process made of great sacrifices too. Sometimes you take steps forward, sometimes you start all over again. And often the goals get further away instead of getting closer. In short, these are two very different phases. At the same time, they are not only consequential, but they also depend on one another. In the end, there is a moment of happiness and joy. The only sad moment after the performance is, as I said before, the feeling of mourning that we artists experience every time a journey ends. Yes, we feel this mourning, but afterwards we go back to work again. We have the possibility to do it again. This young man, on the contrary, go back to a routine that is not as rewarding as when we do theater. When the performance ends, and I have heard you say it loud and clear on several occasions, the real problem isn't really about doing theater in prison. It's about being able to continue outside. It positively affects individuals, but only for a short time. Yes, it's true. People talk a lot about the redeeming function of prison theater. I don't really agree with that. If theater is limited to a one-time experience in the painful life of an individual, if it is an isolated participation, it becomes a space that doesn't save anyone. It doesn't lead anywhere else. It is an experience that should be continued out of prison. The real problem is not making prison theater. The problem is ensuring people have a chance to continue it outside. This is what I'm fighting for. Also, it would be wonderful to create a place, an art atelier, a workshop where these people, once experienced the beauty of theater, can go on, can have the opportunity to repeat these experiences, to train their skills, because they learn a lot. They also learn to see, they learn to understand what contact with others is, what a community that fights together for a common purpose is. These are all values that they discover perhaps for the first time when they encounter theater. And all this could prevent them from returning to a criminal underworld. It would be very important to give them a chance to continue outside prison. I said this several times in the many conferences we attended as theater operators working in Italian prisons. I think it is true, especially for minors, who are given very short prison sentences and whom I would love to see with me in a wonderful place, in a theater, really far from prison walls. There is also the hard work done for building new opportunities, not only for actors or aimed at acting. This is another key aspect. Training them in the crafts connected to theater in order to provide them with skills that can be useful once they'll be outside. Skills to be hopefully used in a place guided by those who showed them the way. Let me ask you one last question. What is, in your opinion, the educational purpose of theater, especially in these painful situations? Well, as I said before, theater teaches them many things. It teaches them to immediately gather and become a community that fights as one for a purpose. It teaches them to face emptiness without fear. So it requires a lot of courage. It teaches them physical and mental contact, a certain kind of contact they have never experienced. They learn to think about things, to act with their bodies, and to feel emotions that they often repress. I would say that there is nothing like theater. It is the infinite scope of theater that gives them the opportunity to discover so much, much more than they have ever known. These are the main purposes, but there is an endless list. There are others that I haven't mentioned. But above all, I think that embarking on a ship heading to a destination that, at the beginning, is unknown and uncertain, well, this teaches them to be brave, to share a common responsibility, to be close. This is what I happen to see. This is perhaps the greatest satisfaction for me, seeing them sailing on a ship that heads to a harbor that is still probably unknown. We really hope it will happen. Thank you, Claudio. Thank you, Valentina. Thank you very much. Thanks to the contributions of Michalis Traitsis, Claudio Collovà, and Valeria Ottolenghi and Valentina Venturini, that had a conversation with them, we saw clearly how theatre in prison is able to create opportunities for dialogue, exchange, and how it raises awareness. Our reference is all about the development of a culture of respect for each and every person. This is possible acknowledging the right to be given intrinsic dignity and value as human being. We received two other significant messages that you will find in full on the website of the Italian Coordination of Theatre in Prison, www.teatrocarcere.it. I would like to quote them here. The following contributions were sent to us by Bernardo Petraglia, head of the Department of Penitentiary Administration, and by Gemma Tuccillo, president of the Department of Juvenile and Community Justice. Through their participation in the theatrical experience, Petraglia writes, prisoners can indeed change their passive attitude with respect to discomfort and difficulties, transforming it into active energy through the symbolic reinterpretation of their own interiority and their own life experiences in the artistic event. We are aware that theatre has proven to be one of the most effective means of connecting the prison context with civil society. It has highlighted the importance of a punishment that is apt to offer prisoners opportunities for training, work, and cultural growth. And even more significant, writes Gemma Tuccillo, was the involvement of young people who entered the correctional system. They have shown particular enthusiasm for theatrical activities. The opportunity of bringing so many emotions, too often repressed or denied, on stage, that of analyzing texts and understanding messages and suggestions, the opportunity of discovering the magic of acting, and why not genuine talents too. These are all fundamental steps for a healthy growth, for the development of self-confidence, for the creation of positive relationships. And all this, Gemma Tuccillo says, is a guarantee of safety of the community. I would also like to remind you that today's initiative is only the inaugural event of the 8th National Day of Theatre in Prison. That is extended, as it was in previous years, to the months of March and April. So until the 30th of April 2021, the Secretariat of the Italian Coordination of Theatre in Prison will collect at the address teatrocarcereitalia@libero.it information about in-person or other events that are taking place in this time of pandemic, also online. In the same period, in 2019, for the 6th National Day of Theatre in Prison, 103 events were promoted in 64 Italian prisons and 66 more in other locations. Respect is a value for theatre communities around the world. It is an equally important value for everyone's life. It is a feeling of profound admiration for someone that comes from their skills, qualities, and achievements. These are the words of Tobias Biancone, Director General of UNESCO's International Theatre Institute. These words were addressed to male and female prisoners and to university and middle school students on the 26th of March 2019 in Pesaro. As head of an official international delegation and together with a Cuban playwright, Carlos Celdran, author of the international message of World Theatre Day in 2019, Professor Biancone came in a prison to officially and symbolically celebrate the ceremony that is usually hosted at the UNESCO's headquarters in Paris. Biancone's words are particularly important for the International Network for Theatre in Prison, that is a partner today of the most important performing arts organization in the world, with its operational offices in Shanghai, China. We will soon listen to a new contribution from his part. His esteem and closeness encourage us to build connections and to work for a culture of respect and reciprocity. Finally, we will listen to the message that the world theatre community entrusted for the year 2021 to the British artist Helen Mirren, one of the best known and most appreciated actresses, with an international career in theatre, cinema and television. She was awarded an Oscar in 2007 as Best Actress in a Leading Role for The Queen and the Golden Bear for Lifetime Achievement at the Berlin Film Festival in 2020. Romina Mascioli of the Enigma University Theatre of Urbino is an actress and operator of prison theatre activities. She will present to us Helen Mirren's message. Thank you for your attention and see you soon.
Onorabile Ministra Cartabia, Onorabile Professore Mauro Palma, caro Vito Minoia, care amiche, cari amici, on behalf of the International Theatre Institute, ITI, and myself, I want to congratulate the organizers for celebrating the 8th edition of the National Day of Theatre in Prison in conjunction with World Theatre Day 2021. I highly estimate the initiative of making theatre and education in theatre techniques accessible to prisoners. It's my own tenet that I follow. Theatre and education in theatre techniques are there for everybody. They should be offered to each and everyone, the young, the senior, the disabled, refugees and migrants, blue collars and white collars, people who live in villages or cities, and for sure, people who are in prisons. In including someone in making theatre, using theatre techniques, involving him or her in the creative process is giving the person a chance to learn, to play a role, and being in dialogue with another person. Over the years, I discovered that bringing theatre into prisons has resulted in opening the door to gain self-respect for those who were participating in a theatre activity. And self-respect is of highest value, not only for a prisoner, but for any human being. The amazing stories that I heard from theatre practitioners using theatre in prisons came from Chile, China, India, Vietnam, Switzerland and Pakistan. But most of the stories came from Italy. Covered by things that happened to someone during a troubled life may make us think that people are bad. But it is my conviction that deep inside of someone there is a point of honor, an attitude of dignity and kindness. Theatre in prison is providing that it is possible to uncover the human self and the dignity of someone by using theatre techniques. I have the highest esteem for all those who support the initiative Theatre in Prison in Italy and all over the world. I have great admiration for all those who dedicate their work by going with theatre into prisons. I witnessed myself this work in Pesaro in 2019 when the main World Theatre Day event was celebrated inside the prison. I look forward to the future story about the positive effects that this initiative has in Italy and all over the world. And I look forward to seeing the theatrical world developed in prisons for the stage. ITI and myself strongly support your initiative in Italy and elsewhere in the world. We strongly support the international network Theatre in Prison, INTIP, that has its roots in Italy and is inspiring other theatre practitioners of the world in their work. Please keep your support for this work. Please continue this work. I wish you a happy National Day of Theatre in Prison and a happy World Theatre Day. Per il momento, sono spiritualmente tra voi. A presto.
Questo è un momento così difficile per lo spettacolo dal vivo. E molti artisti, tecnici, artigiani e artigiane hanno lottato in una professione già piena di insicurezze. Forse questa insicurezza sempre presente li ha resi più capaci di sopravvivere con intelligenza e coraggio a questa pandemia. La loro immaginazione si è già tradotta in queste nuove circostanze in modi di comunicare creativi, divertenti e toccanti, naturalmente soprattutto grazie a Internet. Da quando esistono sul pianeta, gli esseri umani si sono raccontati storie. La bellissima cultura del teatro vivrà finché ci saremo. L'urgenza creativa di scrittori, designer, danzatori, cantanti, attori, musicisti e registi non sarà mai soffocata e nel prossimo futuro rifiorirà con una nuova energia e una nuova comprensione del mondo che noi tutti condividiamo. Non vedo l'ora